Paper was like gold in medieval times.
Oh, not tobacco. Sugar.
That everything we thought we knew about the world might turn out to be completely wrong.
Rachel Khoo, and this beautiful northern city is now my new home. But I, along with most Swedes, often escape to the tranquility of a little cabin in the countryside.
Look at that! It's huge!
Bit of a mouthful, that, isn't it? My Wallenberger at Burgers. Two waffles ready to go. It's not a pea soup without the mustard. A cake worthy of a celebration, I think.
Yay!
Exploring Sweden and all the culinary delights it has to offer will be the source of inspiration in my Swedish kitchen.
Eres mi consentida, tú reinas mi vida. Eres mi consentida, yo vivo por ti.
This is the city of Malmö, situated just across the water from Copenhagen, and only a 20-minute drive from the Danish capital. Despite Malmö being seen by many as Copenhagen's smaller sister town, it has a cosmopolitan and vibrant feel like any large city around the world, mainly due to its rich immigrant population. One of the many benefits to immigration is food. Falafel may now be sold all over the world, but here in Malmö, it's become a cheap favourite with the locals.
Let's try some falafel.
Yeah, let's do that. Can we have two falafel, please?
Fantastic.
At one of the local falafel stores, I'm meeting Linda Dahl, who's actually a fika expert. But before we get to coffee and cookies, we need some Malmö food.
So I heard in Malmö, falafel is really popular.
It is. It's, you could say it's almost like a Malmö's national dish. We're like 177 nationalities living in Malmö. And regardless of religion, regardless of if you're a vegan or a meat eater, or if you're rich or poor, you can always have a falafel. It's sort of a unifying dish for the people in Malmö. And I think that's why it's been so popular. Thank you. This is so delicious. It's all about the mixture. You have this really crispy falafel, and then you have the balance between the salad and the pickled cucumber, and of course, the sauces.
Super crunchy falafel.
You can say that falafel is a kind of vegetarian meatball, and that gives me an idea for my next dish.
The English have fish and chips, the French have coq au vin, and the Swedes have meatballs. My versions are vegetarian meatballs, just as delicious. I'm going to start off by soaking some porcini.
Porcini is a wild forest mushroom with a nutty flavour.
And that's really going to be the backbone of the flavour. While that's soaking, you need to let it soak for about half an hour. I'm going to fry an onion and some mushrooms. The button mushrooms are going to add texture to the bean balls. So while that's cooking, I'm going to whisk together my other ingredients. I've got some allspice, some ground flax seeds. Now the flax seeds, what they will do, they will bind everything. So a bit like how you'd use an egg. And then black beans, they've been drained. Kidney beans, they've been drained too. Also got 100 milliliters of the liquid you get in the tin of beans. That's got starch in it and that will help bind everything. Black pepper, plenty of it. Don't be shy. Salt. And then you just want to mash it all together. Make sure you keep an eye on your mushrooms and onions. Don't want them to burn. Okay, so that's got the consistency I want. It's like a textured kind of paste. I'm going to set that aside. Now, to my bean balls, I'm obviously going to serve a mash, but it's not going to be regular potato mash. I'm going to make a cauliflower and butter bean mash. Just want to get equal size florets so they steam evenly. So you want to steam your cauliflower for about 10 minutes until the florets are tender. Now, my bean balls need a few other ingredients, some breadcrumbs. So I've got my mushroom and onion mix, which has got a lovely caramel color to it. This is gonna add a fantastic flavor to my bean balls. And then I'm gonna add my porcini. So with the porcini, you want to save the liquid it's been soaking in because that's gonna make the base for our gravy. Finely chop your porcini. You want to mix everything together until it's all well combined. You shouldn't end up with a very sticky kind of dough. Get your pan nice and hot, add a little bit of oil, and then you can form your balls. I didn't realize how popular Swedish meatballs were until I moved here. It pops up everywhere, from the nursery, school canteens, at work, at home. Now I just need to fry the bean balls. Make sure it's nice and hot. So what you want to do is just caramelize, crisp up the bottom. You can see it's turning a lovely golden brown color. I'm gonna pop them on the baking tray and into a warm oven, just to keep warm while I make my gravy and finish off my mash. Cover them up before you put them in the oven. To make your gravy, you're gonna need that porcini liquid from earlier. To thicken up my gravy, I'm gonna need some cornstarch. Just add a little bit in there to make a paste. I'm going to use the same pan as I used to fry my bean balls to make the gravy because it has all that lovely flavor in there. Stir in the cornstarch. A teaspoon of yeast extract. This is gonna add that depth of flavor. Finish it off with some black pepper, cream, and a little bit of lemon juice. Just a few drops. Now, last thing to do is the butter, bean, and cauliflower mash. And then we have everything. Cauliflower's done, and then I've got these already cooked butter beans. They go into some cream, of course, white pepper. Unlike mashed potato, you don't have to worry about over mashing it. As always, have a little taste. Mmm, delicious. Right, all I need to do is assemble all the different components together. Generous dollop of mash, bean balls, cucumbers.
You can use good quality store-bought pickled cucumbers.
Gravy, the lingonberries. Don't forget that part.
If you don't have lingonberries, you can serve it with red currant or cranberry jelly.
Last but not least, a sprig of dill. That's it. To my Swedish bean balls. Often the tastiest dishes are the ones that use the simplest ingredients, like my stewed spinach eggs, or as I like to call them, my Swedish green shashuka. Now for my dish, I'm gonna make a spicy red garnish. You can add as little or as much as you like, and if you don't want it as spicy, take out the seeds. Red onion. If
you haven't had shashuka before, it's a dish originally from Tunisia. It's a rich tomato sauce with onions and spices, and you crack eggs into them and you cook it in a pan. So instead of tomato sauce, I'm using traditional Swedish stewed spinach. So that's why it's green. Now, to take the bite off the red onion and the chili, I'm going to make a pickle. Some white wine vinegar. Pinch of salt. A pinch of sugar. And then a couple of tablespoons of water. Give that a little stir. And just let that sit while you make the rest of your other ingredients. For my stewed spinach, I'm going to chop an onion. Add some butter to your pan. Then you can add your onions. Just want to gently fry this. You're softening the onions at this point, you're not caramelizing them. What I love about this dish is it's mainly ingredients you might have in the freezer or in the fridge already. Nothing too exotic, but so simple to put together. To my softened onions, I'm going to add some frozen spinach. And I'm going to cover that up and let it cook covered for 5 minutes. So you can see the spinach has melted. It's a little bit watery at this point, so you need to cook it for about 5 to 10 minutes uncovered to evaporate all the excess water. Now that the spinach has reduced down and it's not watery anymore, I'm going to add my milk and cream. Cream. Lots of white pepper. Be generous with your seasoning. Salt. And then some nutmeg. I really love this flavour, so I tend to put quite a bit in. Don't be shy, be bold. Give it a gentle stir, and you're ending up with this lovely, thick, creamy stewed spinach. So you could eat this just like that, but I'm gonna add some eggs into it. Makes a perfect brunch dish or a light dinner. Great for sharing with friends and family. Last egg. I'm gonna cover that. Cook it for about 5 minutes until the egg whites are set. While that's cooking, I'm gonna toast some bread. Need some dill and chives. You know when the eggs are done is when the egg whites have set. Not quite there yet. This looks like it's done. So I'm gonna add my chili onion garnish. It's kind of essential. You could do it without, but if you don't have this, it's missing that little kick. And then a few sprigs of dill on top for the garnish. A sprinkle of salt on your eggs. Hot toast needs some butter, of course. And then all that's left to do is to take a piece of toast and dip it in the egg yolk. That's the best bit. Mmm.
Now it's time for fika, and I'm meeting up with Linda Dahl again. She knows everything about Swedish fika.
Coffee? Tea?
Coffee.
Okay.
Coffee.
Well, I'm gonna be English.
Yeah.
Cup of tea.
After the Finns, Swedes drink the most coffee in the world with an average of over 1,200 cups of coffee per person per year.
I don't know. Okay, all right. What, like, is it that
no,
bad?
No,
I will
no,
order
no.
a coffee.
No, no. It's all right to have a cup of tea.
The concept of fika is simple. It is the moment that you take a break, often with a cup of coffee and a baked treat. You can do it alone but most often with friends and family.
Swedes tend to see Swedish fika as almost as a human right. And fika is supposed to take time. You're supposed to gossip, connect with friends and family. The fika break is really important. It is mandatory. So, what do you want to begin with?
I think we should just start with the dammsugare, the hoover. The bright green marzipan. Is there a reason why it's called a vacuum cleaner?
This is a no-waste cake. So you take the old scrapes of biscuit and you sort of...
You're really selling it while I'm eating it. It tastes great. And then we have chocolate bolles.
Yeah, chocolate ball. It's basically just oat, butter.
Cocoa powder,
Cocoa powder and sugar.
Very simple ingredients. The one you can make with your kids.
It's the first thing that the kids learn here in Sweden to bake. I think that is chocolate balls.
And then these are actually one of my favorites. I don't know why it's called Sarah.
Well, I'm not really sure. I know who Sarah Bernhardt was. She was a French actress, but maybe this because the French culture have sort of inspired Sweden a lot during the history, as same as British culture.
Well, it's a bit like Pavlova was inspired by a ballerina.
Yeah.
I don't know how you broke into it. It's a bit hard. I might just bite into it because it's like a macaroon at the bottom with a buttercream and then a like chocolate topping, isn't it?
Yes, it is. Nice.
So let's talk about the princess tarte.
Yeah.
The famous princess tarte. They even know about it in England now.
They do?
Yes. This is the most famous Swedish, apart from kanelbulle, cinnamon buns. Kind of cake.
Yeah, I can understand that. When the Princess Victoria here in Sweden had her first child, the princess cake sold out that day. 70% of every cake that are sold in bakery shops are princess cake. So it's really popular.
I'm gonna tuck in.
Yeah, do.
It's just so light and fluffy.
It is. It is a sponge cake. Mm. And then you have this fluffy whipped cream. And you have layers of crème anglaise. In this version, you also have raspberry marmalade. You're actually not supposed to have that in the green one. You're allowed to have it in the pink one.
But we're being controversial.
Yeah, and modern.
Okay, I like how Swedes like to break the rules. Ooh, we're going to have some raspberry
marmalade in the green princess cake.
In Sweden, there is morning fika, after lunch fika, afternoon fika, and sometimes even evening fika. Though most Swedes might not sit down and relax with a cup of coffee four times a day, they do have fika once or twice.
A typical Swedish biscuit has to be havreflan. Oh my goodness, I can't speak Swedish. Forget it. It's oat cookies, basically. Really simple, crunchy, very satisfying. My version is a little bit different to the traditional version, which uses sugar, flour, oats. I'm going to use bananas, very ripe ones, to sweeten the biscuit. The riper they are, the better. So the bananas you really don't want to eat anymore. They're perfect. Pinch of salt, teaspoon of ground vanilla, and then some oats. Mix that all together till you have a slightly wet oat dough. Baking tray lined with baking paper, and then a cookie cutter, roughly about 6 centimeters wide. So just take some of the oat dough and then press it into your cookie cutter to make a round. So you want the cookies to be a couple millimeters thick and even. It's really important they're even because then they'll bake evenly. Just repeat until you've filled the tray. The last cookie's done. I've preheated my oven to 220 degrees, really hot oven. And they're gonna go in for about 10 to 15 minutes and then you need to flip them over. So the biscuits are done. You can see they're done because they've got lovely golden edges and they sound crisp. You could eat them just like they are. keep them in an airtight container, they'll keep for a couple of days, or dip them in some chocolate. I'm gonna melt some chocolate. I'm using dark chocolate, but you could use milk chocolate if you'd like. My chocolate has melted. I'm just gonna give it a little dip, like so. If you find the chocolate too hot to handle, just use a spoon to spread on the chocolate. Now, what I like to do is sprinkle a little bit of finishing salt on my chocolate. It just brings out that chocolate flavour, makes these biscuits extra special. It's not a traditional touch, but it's extremely delicious. 5 ingredients is all you need for my oat cookies. Banana, oats, chocolate, vanilla, and a pinch of salt. Malmö, with its large immigrant population, has a rich and diverse food scene, which I thoroughly enjoyed exploring. It reflects Sweden of today and potentially Sweden of the future.